The church gives us today different options for readings, but the readings that we have just heard, the first reading, as well as the psalm and the gospel, are the readings prescribed for the day. And I thought, what better way than to look to the wisdom of the church to seek nourishment from the Word of God for today. King David, about whom we heard in the first reading, was a sinful man, as are all of us. Just like him, we are all sinners. Today we call to mind the murder of the innocent through the sin of abortion. David was a murderer, and he murdered an innocent man. You're all familiar with the story. Before you begin to feel so good about yourself, telling yourself that you are not a murderer, let me remind you that there are many different forms of murder. When you kill the innocent spirit, for example, of a child, allowing them to witness your fight and your argument with your husband or your wife, you kill that child's spirit inside, causing them irreparable harm in many respects. When you kill someone's spirit by calling them names, how often do we murder people with our tongue? When you slander someone by making something up about them, when you gossip, our Holy Father, Pope Francis, tells us that gossipers are terrorists because they throw bombs and they wait for them to explode. And so terrorists are killers. And we are all guilty of the sin of gossip. In our past, we have all engaged in that. So you see, before we begin to pat ourselves on the back thinking that we are better than others, let me remind you that we are all sinners. Not one of us here is better than anyone else. Not one of us here is better than a woman who has committed the sin of abortion. We are all sinners. We are not better than other people. The Bible says in Romans, in the book of Romans, chapter 3, verse 23, "For all men have sinned and have fallen short of the glory of God." That is all men, that's all of us, including you. I also want to point out that if you focus on the story of David, you will see that while the sin of adultery is a sin, nothing displeased or angered God more than the sin of taking the life of an innocent man, Uriah. The Bible says, "But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord the most." This statement was in the context of Nathan the prophet pinning David to the wall about the murder of Uriah, Bathsheba's husband. This is why it is so vital that we keep the fight alive to end the killing of the innocent in our day and age, because nothing displeases God more than the death of the innocent. Uriah was innocent, and David put him to death. King David, if you're not familiar with the story, stayed home from war in a time when kings usually got into war. While walking on the roof of his palace, he sees a beautiful woman, Bathsheba, bathing. Yep, he saw everything. Instead of fleeing the temptation, he indulged himself and lusted after her. and her husband was off to war. So he arranged to have her brought to him, and he slept with her. We have no idea if she resisted, but I suspect you didn't resist the king in those days. She became pregnant from their little escapade or rendezvous, or whatever you'd like to call it. Doesn't that remind you of today, what we're calling to mind, that led to the grave sin of David? David panicked. I hope that, you know, the church is giving us these readings today. There's a great wisdom here. It should be resonating right now. David panicked. Isn't this what happens so often when people are led to the sin of abortion? And immediately began an elaborate cover-up plan that failed. Does that not remind you of the cover-ups that take place? As a last resort, he had Bathsheba's husband put in the most dangerous part of the battle, where he would certainly be killed. And the mission was accomplished, and he was indeed killed. The result of adultery would sin would soon be evident to all. So he sought to do whatever he had to do in order to cover up his sin. It involved the murder of an innocent man. For thousands of years, the sin he tried to cover up is one of the things David is most known for. Doesn't this remind you of abortion? Where so many women and men come up with a plan to cover up their sins? It is the same sin, the killing of the innocent. David was truly ashamed of what he had done. Read Psalm 51. David is the author of the Psalms. So if you read Psalm 51, you will see that he becomes repentant. Throughout history, millions who have given in to all sorts of temptations have tried to cover up their sin similarly. And so the cover-up begins. The child, the innocent party, is premeditatedly murdered to cover up mom and dad's sin. And as in David's case, the thing that mom and dad have done displeased the Lord. And David soon regretted and admitted his sin. He regretted and admitted his sin. That's why he's David. He regretted and admitted his sin. He knew he had greatly displeased the Lord and was in danger of having little fellowship with God. So he repented and he asked for forgiveness in the way that the sin deserved. He admitted the sin and he asked for forgiveness. This is Psalm 51. Create in me a clean heart, O God, he says, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners shall return to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God. You are the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud your goodness. David repented and asked the Lord for the Holy Spirit that gave him the courage to seek forgiveness. And David lived a successful, fruitful, and forgiven life after displeasing the Lord. He's King David. From his line came our great Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, this is what we as a church proclaim, that even after a sin such as taking the life of the innocent, The same sin that King David was guilty of. Even after such a sin, anyone who asks in the same way as David for the forgiveness of God with a repentant heart can be forgiven. And so can anyone receive that same forgiveness. It is amazing how a holy God can be greatly offended at a horrible sin and yet forgive, love, and bless. And this is precisely where our gospel today comes in. You see how they're all related? The church has great wisdom for us, and we trust in the wisdom of the Lord. Our gospel today comes in when Jesus is speaking about the one sin that is unforgivable. It is what he calls the sin against the Holy Spirit. Now we know that there are no limits to God's mercy. Pope Francis reminds us of that over and over again. He says the name of God is mercy. But anyone who deliberately refuses to accept his mercy, and this is the teaching of our church, anyone who deliberately refuses to accept his mercy by repenting, rejects the forgiveness of God, rejects the forgiveness of his sins, and the salvation offered by the Holy Spirit. You see, it is the hardness of our hearts when we continue to focus on our sin and not on the forgiveness of God that is the sin against the Holy Spirit. It's like the people who come over and over again to confession, and they confess stuff that they have already confessed and been forgiven for. This is particularly the case of people who commit grave sins and they focus on those sins, such as the sin of abortion, and they have been forgiven in the confessional. When the priest says, "I absolve you of your sin is forgiven," and yet you continue to focus on that sin. You're not focused on a God of mercy who can forgive you anything and everything just because you ask him for that forgiveness with a repentant heart, but you are focused on your sin. And so you make an idol of your sin. You do not worship a forgiving God, a merciful God, but you begin to worship your sin. You do not adore a forgiving, a merciful God, but you adore your sin. Stop it! David stopped. He lived the forgiveness and the mercy of God, just like all of us have fallen short, the Bible says. All men have fallen short of the glory of God. But where sin abounds, there grace abounds even more. That's what we have to focus on. Not that you commit sins or that you have made mistakes in the past, but you focus on the mercy of God. Pope John Paul II reminds us that this unforgivable sin consists in the refusal to accept the salvation which God offers to men through the Holy Spirit. In other words, it is a stubborn sin. I am stubborn. I refuse to believe that God has forgiven me. I refuse to believe in the mercy of God. How can we do that? We focus on the forgiveness and the mercy of God and the moment of forgiveness. This is very well illustrated by the story of Clara Barton. Clara Barton, the founder of the Red Cross, she had something very horrible happen to her in her life. Speaking of adultery, which is brought to us today through the sin of King David, Clara Barton had her husband cheat on her with her best friend. Can you imagine that? That's a tough one. She had her husband cheat on her with her best friend. And after a while, Clara Barton began to speak to her best friend and hang out with her. Again, she recounts this in her autobiography. And not only that, she took her husband back. And all the people, you know how people are, began to say, Clara, don't you remember what she did to you and what he did to you? Don't you remember what she did? And Clara says, no, I don't remember what she did or what my husband did. I remember, but she says, I remember the moment in which I chose to forgive her and to forgive him. I don't remember what they did, but I remember the moment of forgiveness. That is how God is with each and every one of us. God doesn't remember. God has no memory. We do. That's why it's so hard for you to forget all the stuff that other people have done to you and what you have done, because you have a memory. God doesn't. God forgets and is calling us to the same thing. Not to focus on all that we have done in our life or what other people have done, but to focus on the moment of forgiveness when God forgives us. This is our church. Today we gather here in church on a day like this because the church brings reconciliation and forgiveness, and particularly forgiveness and reconciliation and mercy to people who have been so wounded by the sin of abortion. And I see so many of you here who are involved in Rachel's Vineyard and in the homes for unwed mothers, those of you who work by bringing reconciliation and hope to so many, the hope of forgiveness. And this is the message of the Lord today to us, that no matter what sins we may commit, even a sin as horrible as the sin of King David, the sin of killing someone innocent, that sin, if you come to God with a repentant heart, and you say, I am sorry, and I want to be forgiven, that God forgives you. The world and the devil calls you to despair. The Lord calls you to hope. The devil wants you to despair. The Catechism teaches us that despair means to cease to hope for our personal salvation from God and for help in attaining it and for the forgiveness of our sins. Despair is contrary to God's goodness. Despair is contrary to who God is. We are people of life. We are people of hope. We are not people of despair. We are people of mercy, and let that mercy reign as we today call to mind a very horrible event in the life of our nation. We also call to mind, as the Bible teaches us, that where sin abounds, grace increases and abounds even more. Amen.